Welcome to Hypnosis Today, the show that explores how people are using hypnosis to achieve remarkable things. My name is Lisa Mackenberg, and I'll be your host as we meet everyday people who are using hypnosis and the power of the subconscious mind to achieve happiness, success, and prosperity. Well, my very special first guest is Britt Shefflin. Now, Britt is an honors grad of HMI College of Hypnotherapy, and she has with her her very special guest, Sarah. Sarah came in to see Britt to overcome claustrophobia. Please help me welcome my guests. Well, Sarah, I'd like to start with you. How did you find HMI College?
I found HMI mostly out of desperation, and I really knew I needed to at least start to conquer my phobia. And I think I just went on Google after someone mentioned, oh, why don't you try hypnosis? And I found the Institute.
And you were very, very brave. As a matter of fact, I know that, oh my gosh, a long time ago, you came in and you did a case history with me with one session. And after that, we chose a hypnotherapy intern to work with you. And that was Britt Shefflin. So tell me, you said that you were getting desperate. What was going on where you got onto the internet and you knew that you had to do something to have a better quality of life?
I just felt like I wasn't normal anymore, and my fiance and I really enjoyed going to movie theaters, but that enjoyment was being marred by my increasing levels of anxiety in enclosed spaces to the point where I wasn't able to enjoy the films with him. I wasn't looking forward to vacations that cost lots of money because the fact of having to be in an airplane for an extended period of time. And then lastly, my elevator thing was just getting out of control. I couldn't even fathom getting onto it, so I would have to walk up 15 flights. So
it sounds like it was really impacting your life, but it was also impacting the life of people around you.
Right.
And for anybody who's wondering, should I get treatment for a fear or phobia when it begins to impact your life? The answer is yes. So Britt, I'd like to go with you. First of all, did we know if this was a fear or phobia? And what is the difference?
Yeah, so we have to discover whether it's a fear or phobia. And a fear comes from a known source, a known incident that happened at a fixed point in time. And a phobia is kind of generalized, and you might not know exactly how to pinpoint when it began, and it can come on suddenly, and it tends to increase in severity over time.
Did you find that you couldn't really pinpoint a traumatic event, but it started to come on slowly?
There were events that I'd started to piece together within my sessions that may have contributed to my phobia, but not an actual, like, that's why.
So that really is a phobia. And as you said, Britt, the thing about phobias is they begin to accumulate, they begin to get worse, and untreated, they can turn into agoraphobia. That's not fear of agora, for those of you from California. That is the reluctance to even leave the house because you might encounter something that's scary out there. So how do you treat someone who has a phobia instead of a fear?
Oftentimes, phobias are connected to hypoglycemia or blood sugar. So in this instance, we definitely took a look at diet and keeping blood sugar stabilized, first of all, and then we used systematic desensitization to help her get normalized and to see the triggering events in a repeated fashion while being in the state of hypnosis so that you're very relaxed. And if you do that repetitively, your subconscious mind gets so used to it that it doesn't know the difference between fantasy and reality. And so to the subconscious mind, it then becomes more normal.
I want to unpack this a little bit with Sarah. I'm noticing that you have little tiny wrists, so do I, which can be an indication of just the body having a little bit of an issue regulating our blood sugar. What happens to you when you skip a meal or two?
I feel disoriented, and I feel like my heart rate increasing, a little dizzy. It's very uncomfortable.
Is that similar to the feelings that you get when you think about going on an elevator or an airplane or a movie theater where you're sitting in the middle row and every seat is taken? So there's your correlation. How did you learn to eat for your particular physiology from Brett?
So what helped me a lot was increasing my level of proteins and then always making sure that I carried a little something in my purse. So if I'm walking in like a crowded space, like I'm all, that was one of my things. And I felt, oh, that little feeling of uncomfortability, I would go in my purse and get a bag of nuts. And then afterward, I'd be like, okay, it was because I was feeling that hypo feeling, not because I'm actually in danger and anxious.
It was a blood sugar drop. And they do, they mimic a panic attack almost for some people. I'm one of them. Now you mentioned something else. You mentioned something called systematic desensitization. For our lay audience, here in the studio audience or anybody watching at home, what is systematic desensitization?
So systematic desensitization is when you put the client into hypnosis, into a very relaxed alpha-theta state, slowing down the brain waves, getting them nice and comfortable, and then bringing up things that would normally trigger them in a cognitive state, and allowing them to use what's called an ideomotor response.
What's that?
It's where if you feel any discomfort, you can let the hypnotherapist know by raising one finger, and after a while it becomes automatic so that you can tell if they're feeling any sort of discomfort without them having to consciously signal you. And so we repeat the same scenarios over and over, sometimes with increasing intensity, until you get to the point where it's no longer triggering.
You know, it's interesting the way that the human mind works. We can't really sustain anxiety unless there's something really life-threatening out there. And when we go over it in our imagination over and over again, the subconscious mind, you know, it has the maturity of an 8-year-old. And just like an 8-year-old, after a while, it becomes boring and uninteresting and no longer triggers us. What was it like being in hypnosis and thinking about, well, let's start with the one that you described, a movie theater. And imagine being in a movie theater and imagining that with all 5 senses, but you're in the safety of Britt's office. Were you able, in the hypnotic trance, to no longer get anxious at all being in a movie theater? So that's called in vivo, that's in the imagination. But then you did it in vitro, that means live or in real life. Did you go to a movie?
Oh yeah.
What did you see?
I saw the Deadpool 2.
Hey, how did you like it?
It was so good. And I had no problem at all. Like I could actually enjoy the film instead of that feeling.
And that's a good one. Mm-hmm. That's a good one, it's a very funny franchise. Mm-hmm. So you went, and you were able to go with your boyfriend mm-hmm. and enjoy the movie. Was he impressed? What did he have to say?
He was, I think, relieved for me because it's something that we had enjoyed in the past mm-hmm. and it's something he really like pushes me to go and see things with him. So I think he was just like, yes, she's back, you know.
She's back, that is amazing. Now, do we start with the scariest thing that the person can think of or the least scariest thing? How would we make a hierarchy with someone who is having a phobia about multiple things?
Sure. So we actually made a bulleted list in order from least provoking to most anxiety inducing. And we started with the least, which I believe was movie theaters. Mm-hmm. And then once you create the success of having comfort in a movie theater, you begin to realize that all of these other things are now possible. And then so we moved up to the next thing, which was malls. And once you get comfortable in hypnosis, being in a mall in a repetitive way, then you can go out into the real world and your mind just generalizes it into real life.
So Sarah, what was the highest thing on your hierarchy?
I felt like sometimes it was between planes and then elevators, depending if I had a flight coming up. But I think now it's elevators.
It was elevators. Mm-hmm. That's interesting because, you know, a fear of flying or a phobia of flying is why have one phobia when you can have all in one? There's a fear of heights, there's a fear of claustrophobia, of being closed spaces, there's germophobia, there's fear of loss of control, and why have one when you can have four? But once you treat one, the other ones seem to fall away. You know, here at HMI College of Hypnotherapy, where we have our beautiful studio, we have an elevator. Were you able to take the elevator here at HMI College?
I would sneeze, but yeah, it's true. We did. I think 2 weeks ago, we went on it together, and then I went on it today twice. Cool.
Wow.
Yes.
That's excellent.
Thank you, reinforcing.
Yes, and our elevator makes all kinds of really interesting noises. You know, it can be the haunted elevator. It's not. It's not Wave Sage, but it does. It can make some very interesting noises, although the elevator here at HMI College has always gotten me to exactly the floor I've needed to go to with absolutely no issues, and that's been for over 20 years. What was it like for you the very first time you took the elevator here?
I think the buildup was a lot worse, like waiting with just Brit, and then going through it was not nearly, I think, as bad as maybe either one of us had anticipated it was going to be. And then when I got out, it was just this rush, maybe of endorphins, but just thinking like, okay, I've done something that was just really hard, and especially these elevators, as you mentioned.
Yes, and that is that rush of self-esteem through mastery. Now, we have three floors. Have you been able to go up a building that has 15 floors? Have you been able to go up to the penthouse and seen the view below you?
I had a recent trip to Philadelphia, and I had to take the elevator because we were on the 15th floor, and so I was able to do that on my trip.
By yourself, or did someone have to go and hold your hand?
Someone went and held my hand, but it still felt good to do it.
And yeah. How about if we flew to Philadelphia tomorrow, and I said, can you run up to the top floor and grab my blue mug and bring it back down to me while I return a call? Could you do it?
Lisa, I would do it.
You do it for me.
I do it for you, and then, but yes, I would do it. Yes.
And how would it feel?
It would probably feel, hopefully by that point, like normal, because that's what my goal was always to feel, was just normal.
That is a beautiful word. It sounds so funny to just think I'm normal and I do normal things that normal people do.
Yeah.
What a wonderful goal. It really is. What would you say to someone who had some phobias or even a fear about seeing a hypnotherapist?
Oh, absolutely. Just try it out. It doesn't have to be something that you do for the rest of your life, but it really helped me, and I've already told some friends about it. So,
how about working with Brit?
Oh, Brit's been amazing.
Why?
Just, I never felt a judgment or like a pushing. I think she was very... She was able to help me push myself, but yes. Not like her pushing my buttons. Like on a day I didn't really feel like doing the elevator, it wasn't a thing. She was like, that's fine.
That's fine, because she really trusted you, so you could trust yourself. And I just want everybody here in the studio audience and everybody at home or anyone who is a student here at HMI College of Hypnotherapy, like Brit, sign up for our intern program where you can get a wonderful client. And when you're still under supervision, you can have amazing success like Brit has in the safety of while you're still attending the school right here. I want to thank you so much, Sarah, for coming and sharing this very personal and very successful experience. I'd like to thank you, Brit Shefflin, for coming in and teaching us about the differences between fears and phobias and how we can treat them in a hypnotherapy office. And I know that everybody is going to want to see Brit Shefflin and learn these techniques for yourself and for your clients too. And you can reach Brit Shefflin on hmigrads.com. Stay tuned, we have a lot more coming up for you on hypnosistv.com 24/7. Thank you. That was amazing.